Hello, welcome to our sixth lecture. Today is holiday in some places, but we are working. Thank you everybody for being here. So today we will finally see that an example of a expected recurse function that is continuous, not just polyhedral as all the cases we have been seeing for discrete distribution. So for continuous distribution, it is not the case. It is, there is a smoothing effect because we have a sampling space that is continuous. And we will also prove a theorem on optimality conditions characterizing the solutions of a two-stage stochastic linear program. Okay, so let's start with the beginning, the usual beginning. Don't forget to set the resolution to 480 pixels. And then I want to make a comment because I said something slightly wrong last time when I was defining a class of measurable sets when we revised fastly the concepts of measurability. So everything is correct. Everything that is written is correct is what I said that was slightly inaccurate. So remember, we had a class that was abstract in the probability space, and we had the measure that was allowing us to define the size of the sets in this class. And the class was defined in an axiomatic way so that every time a set was measurable, its complement is measurable too, and the union of sets that are disjoint pairwise has a measure that is given by the sum of the individual measures. And by the way, here this should be F and F, right? Not A and I, because we're in F here. Okay, so everything is okay. The sets in this class are the events in the probability space, and the triplet defines the probability space. So we have the sampling space omega, the set of measurable functions in that is capital F or calligraphic F, and the measure P. The set of the class of measurable functions, this calligraphic F, is called a sigma algebra. Okay, this is the name, and I said that it was a filtration. That was the mistake. It is a filtration when we will. It will be a filtration when we will study the multi-stage problems where we have more than one opportunity to apply the recurse and correct the. Decision made in the previous stages. So uncertainty, now we're assuming that uncertainty becomes known from one time forever in the future, while for this multi-stage setting that will be explained by Wellington, there is a successive steps where the realization becomes known. For example, in the gas example, the oil production example, it would be, it is known from one day to the next one, what is the, or the 1 week to the next one, what is the actual demand of premium gasoline. And then the week after that, we have to wait one more week to wait until the realization of the new uncertainty. And if we make our horizon of decision is 1 month, then we will have successive stages where we will get to know more and more the uncertainty. In this case, this F here will be a filtration, and it will be a set of sigma algebras, okay? So this is just a precision not to confuse you. I hope not to confuse you with these explanations. Okay, so recall that to illustrate all the properties of the expected recurse function, we consider a very simple case that is sufficient to explore all the properties of this function, that we are in R then, and we have only this stochastic equality to which we give a meaning, we make this problem tractable, by a model with recurse. This problem, we make it tractable by setting a model with recurse, which means then that we will add here variables y plus and y minus, that will be the wait and see variables, plus a cost of that will correspond to the cost of making these corrections. And then this gives rise to the recurse function, That is now a very simple linear programming problem for each first stage variable, or here and now decision variable, and each realization of uncertainty that enters here only here in the right-hand side. So this is a linear programming problem. We have only vectors as variables. Well, here there are not even vectors, there are scalars. And this is our recurse problem. So the model that treats uncertainty for the stochastic linear programming problem, here is this two-stage linear program that has this form. And we proved last class, well, 2 days ago, that the dual feasible set of the recurse problems, of the wait and see problems, is not empty is if and only if the recurse is sufficiently expensive. Oh, forgot the larger than zero. Here there is larger than zero. Okay, and for the particular case when we have that the recurse for shortage and for surplus is equal to 1, then this recurse function has a closed expression, and it becomes just the absolute value of omega minus x. So it's very clear that it is piecewise linear. And if we have a finite support, then we will have k realizations of uncertainty here, wk, and the expected recurse function that now we call phi of x because it will be shorter. So in this class, in this lecture, it will be phi of x, is convex and is polyhedral. And the kinks, well, that is the points where there is a discontinuity in the derivative, it's a point wk here that constitute the events in our probability, in our sampling space, the probability space omega. Okay, and then so well, that is here it will be just a sum if they all have the same probability. For example, we can consider the if omega has a uniform distribution in the set of 0, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so only those three, four points. So W1, 2, 3, and 4, then K is equal to 4. We consider that they are equally equiprobable, then phi of x will be 1/4, and the sum of those, so w goes first, right? So it's 0 minus x plus absolute value of 1 minus x plus absolute value of 2 minus x plus absolute value of 3 minus x. 6, x. Okay, I will not write there anymore. But well, you see, it is clearly, it's a function that has kinks. Of this type. And these kinks are the points where the absolute value function is not differentiable, and it's not differentiable at the when the argument is equal to 0. So it is when x is equal to w1, w2, w3, or w4. These are the kinks of this function. Okay, so now the long-time promise that today will finally be answered, but it will require some work from you because it will be we will have some an exercise here. Is what happens when omega is a continuous set? We have a continuous distribution. The probability distribution is continuous. Okay, so now what is the change? The change is that instead of the sum, we will have an integral, and taking with the measure of probability that defines our space. Now, for integrating with respect to the probability measures, sometimes it's a little complicated, and it is useful when in the probability the distribution is one of the well-known ones, for example, the uniform one. This is what we will do, the example. It is useful to rewrite this integral in terms of variables in R. And for that, we make use of the cumulative distribution function, f of z, that to each real assigns the probability that the So it is the cumulative distribution function of the random variable xi. Mm? So it assigns the probability that for the events in the sampling space, the random variable is smaller than z. Mm? So here it's a number between 0 and 1 because the probability, here is a number between 0 and 1. Mm? And z can be any real number. And so it is a more handy object to integrate with respect to the CDF than to make the integration here with the respect to the probability measurement. So paired with the CDF, there is the 1 minus the cumulative distribution function that is called the tail of the distribution, where we see the probability that the random variable is larger than z. And then it's, well, here we're denoting it with a bar on top, f bar of z. So here the sum of those two functions is equal to 1. Okay, so now to make all our calculations, we will take then the recurse cost equal to 1, so that we have our recurse function equal to the absolute value. And we will consider, instead of a discrete distribution, a uniform distribution, now a continuous uniform distribution in the interval AB for A and B. I don't know, here I put, let me put parentheses so that we don't have squares, twice squares, AB. So the comparison that we will make will be to respect to A equals 0 and B equals 3. Mm? So uniform in 0, 3. A uniform distribution in 0, 3. So we, that is you, I will give you hints, will show that this function phi, in fact, is a very smooth function, and for each x0 in the interval where the uniform distribution is defined, has this form, x0 squared plus x0 minus a squared divided 2 times b minus a. In fact, I made these calculations. I didn't take it from any book, so you will tell me if I made the calculations right, okay? I think it is. Okay, but in particular, you see that if we take a equals 0 and b equals 3, our expected recurse function will be 2x0 divided by 2 divided by 3. So it's 1/3 x0 squared, right? And then you can compare. Square. Mm? You can compare with the continuous, with the discrete version. Mm? Okay, so how is it that we prove these relations? We will use, as I said, to make the integral here, a relation that you will also show between the integral with respect to the probability measure and the integral involving the tail of the distribution, so that we can integrate in R. And for that, we need to know what are the probability, the CDF, and the tail of the uniform distribution. And then for the continuous version, then we have that the tail, the CDF, so the probability that the random variable is smaller than the left interval, extreme of the interval, is equal to 0. Then if we are to the right of the interval, the probability is equal to 1, because we have explore all the interval. And this is expression if we x is in the open interval AB. And the tail, well, it's the symmetric, or I don't know, the corresponding relation, so that we always add to 1 in this in each line. 1 if c is smaller than a, this expression in the open interval, and 0 if c is larger than b. Mm? So with these expressions, then now, the first important result that you will have to show is that the expected, and this is general, it doesn't depend on the distribution while considering it, If we have a random variable that takes non-negative values, that is our case here, and this is why we are taking here a larger or equal to 0, then the expected value of the random variable, so what we use here in the integral, the probability measure, is the same than integrating between 0 and plus infinity the tail, now in R. So with respect to the variable that looks at the probability of C smaller or equal than, or larger or equal than C. So this is a result that you have to prove, and I will tell at the end of the class when you will send it and where you will send it, scan or give it in hands to me. So then, now, why? How is it that we use this? We have our expected records function or any number in R. Then we can express it as the sum of the positive part and the negative part. Then, if we do this, we will have our random variable that will be positive in both cases, C plus and C minus. And then we will write our function phi is the expected value of this records function. Then we will compute the individual expected values of the positive part and of the negative part. Okay, so in this case, then we can use these results, this here, to show those two equalities. And we, that means you, again. So this is an exercise, it's a homework, that the expected value of, for the, now it is, now here, yes, this result is for the uniform distribution in AB, we have A and B. Then the expected value of the positive part, then it's the integral, and we are evaluating at x0. So here we have it's the integral between x0 and b of the tail. This follows from these relations. And the expected part of the expected value of the negative part is the integral between a and x0 of the CDF. So this is this can be shown using this result, and here there is a hint for you that can be useful for these relations. Well, and then once you have these equalities, you just need to add those two expected values, and then we get our function phi, and it's just we'll have to integrate a very simple function that will be quadratic. So that we get our function phi, for example, here of this form, when a is a 0 and b is 3. Okay, so this is the my gift, my Easter gift for you, so to do these calculations. Okay, now actually I can say now, I'm getting hot because I have to wear this for the microphone. So I maybe you can let's fix the date and let's fix where you will send when if you are not here. Just scan this exercise that your response and send it to Svanprog. Let's send it to svanprog@impa.br. I don't know how to write IMPA, that's serious. Okay, IMPA.br. Before next class, it will be 29, no? 29 is next class? Okay, then let's say the 30. Okay, so it's something to do, some exercise calculations to do while you are in the bus, coming to import something. Okay, so now let's go into the optimality conditions. And as usual, we will separate the case where we have a finite support or a continuous one. So what do we mean by optimality conditions? We have our two-stage stochastic linear program that now we write in this form. So the linear first stage cost plus the expected recurse cost. And we take our here and now variables over a polyhedron that is of this form, non-negative variables and equality constraints. And well, just for fixing the dimensions, the matrix has NB lines and NX columns. Let's say A is NB times NX. Okay, and since we are in the finite support case, we have k scenarios, and then the expected value is just a sum with a positive probability of evaluating at each x the realization of the individual scenario k that here we wrote in the general form xk, because now we are no more in our illustrating example, and xk is x of wk. Right, is the random variable evaluated at the kth event wk. Okay, and then that means that we have to put k's in all our random data, q, w, h, and t, and we have the primal and the dual expressions. Good. So the optimality conditions are a system of inequalities that the data has to satisfy at a certain point for that point to be declared a minimum, a solution to this problem. For example, something that the problem has to, point needs to satisfy is to be feasible, things like this. And there is always attached to the primal object that solves the primal problem, multipliers that are related to the constraints. Here in those ones, or here to the variables in the dual formulation of the second stage problems. Okay, to make our proof, we will need to show some results. So we will start, and this is independent of being continuous or discrete. Those results hold for, because there is no distribution, in fact, involving these results. So let's prove this, the first one. Recalling that, so we said that the point needs to be feasible, so it needs to be in the set capital X, and capital X is a set of points such that X is larger than 0 and AX is equal to B. Now, to the a function that assigns a value to the fact of that the point belongs or not to this set is called the indicator function. I that goes from R and X to the extended reals such that to each X it assigns the value 0 IX. Sorry, here. So it is called the indicator function of the set X. So 0 if X belong is feasible, so it is in our set, and plus infinity otherwise. So if the set X is closed and convex, we have a question? Yes, if one, it will be full domain, the way we will apply it. Yes, here there is an int missing. Let me go back to the first one. So So, okay, so if X is closed and convex, well, and non-empty, then this indicator function is proper and convex. Proper and convex function. It's a convex function, right? It's a proper convex function. Now, what is the subdifferential of a convex function? It is the set of all the subgradients, and the subgradients were the slopes of all the hyperplanes that were tangent to the function and supporting the graph of the function from below. This is a fancy wording for a very simple relation, is that S belongs to the subdifferential here of this function, Ix at x bar, if and only if Ix of x is larger than, so the graph of the function stays above the hyperplane that passes through x bar and has slope s. And this for all x in R and X. Okay, so from this relation, we have then to characterize what is the subdifferential of this indicator function. Then the first observation is, well, X bar is feasible, so it's in X. We're assuming that X bar is in X, in capital X. Then this means that this value is zero. And then what we have to find is slopes S such that this inequality holds for all X in Rn. What is S? Who is S? Okay, so if X is not in the set, this value is plus infinity. So it holds, the inequality holds trivially. For any S, doesn't matter what S is. So any S would satisfy the relation. And if the, so we have to look, so this is one case. The second case, if X is feasible, X is in the set capital X, then the indicator function is zero. So S needs to satisfy the inequality zero larger than is transpose X minus X bar, and this for all X in the capital X set. And this reminds you of some definition, and if it doesn't, I will. This is the definition of the normal cone of the set X at the point X bar. The angle between the normal elements and the differences of points that are in the set needs to be obtuse. So that is, the scalar product is negative, right? This is the definition of this. It's equivalent to say, to saying that S is a normal element to the set A capital X at the point X bar. Mm? So the subdifferential of an indicator function, we have proved that first result. The subdifferential of an indicator function at the point X bar with X bar in the set is just the normal cone, the cone normal to the set at that particular point X bar. Okay, so we pursue our characterization, and then we will see what is this, the normal cone to this polyhedron X bar, X capital X, that has specific form. So now let's go and prove our second result. Mm? We have our set X capital X that is given here. So here we finish our proof. And then we have the normal cone . The definition is the set of elements n in R and nx such that, well, here we call them S. Let's call them S. Okay, let's call them S. It's okay. S in R and x such that S transpose x minus x bar is smaller or equal to 0 for all x feasible. And then we have this other set that we have to prove that is equal n, that is the set of nu in R and nx of the form that use the specific structure now of the set. Nu is equal to minus A transpose mu minus P for some vector mu without any specification that doesn't have to satisfy any property, just to be in the right, have the right dimension, that must be NB here. And P, yes, it has to satisfy some conditions. P has to be, is in, okay, P, I will write it here, so that is similar to how it's in the black in the slides. P is in Rn x, and it has to be non-negative, and there is some complementarity between P and x. There is not some complementarity, there is complementarity. Blessings, somebody sneezed. So the scalar product between this non-negative variable P and the non-negative x bar, because x bar is in the set A capital X that has only non-negative elements, have to be 0. So when x bar is strictly positive, P is 0. And when x bar is 0, it can be P can be 0 or strictly positive. It doesn't matter. But what the complementarity, this is a complementarity relation. OK, so I will prove one inclusion, the easy one, and I will let you the difficult one. And you will add it to the scan. Okay, so we will prove this inclusion. No, we will take then a new of this form. With those properties for the P term. And then what we have to do is just this inner product here and see if the sign is negative. So a new transpose and take then X in capital X. X we have, it's given and it's in capital X. Then, so we will do the inner product between nu and the difference between X and X bar. Here is minus let's write everything. Minus A transpose mu minus P transpose times X minus X bar. So now we distribute. This is minus A transpose mu transpose X minus X bar minus P transpose X minus X bar. So here, transposing means that we change the order of the product. So we have mu transpose times A transpose transpose is A times X minus X bar minus the same term, P transpose X minus X bar. And we are not bad, we're already there, because X and X bar, they are both in the set capital X here. So AX bar is equal to B and AX is equal to B. So this product here is B minus B, and this inner product is zero. So this is equal to 0 minus P transpose X minus X bar. And now we look and remember what is it that P was satisfying as condition. So P transpose X bar is 0. So the second term vanishes too. And we are left with minus P transpose X. And P is positive or non-negative. X is non-negative, the inner product then is non-negative, minus, it's smaller or equal than zero. So we proved the inequality that we needed to prove to show that nu belongs to the normal cone. Of X to X, I said X bar. The reverse inclusion uses some separating hyperplanes results. So do it and scan it and send it to SpanProg. So also before the CERTIS. N contains N X of X homework. SpanProg. Sorry. Okay, good. So we have proved the first result, half of the second. We will use this. And now we need to know what is it that characterizes the minimum of a function. By the way, okay, before going in here, let me motivate why is it that we are doing all these calculations. Remember that we want to solve to find optimality conditions for the first stage problem that is of the form minimize C transpose X plus the expected record function subject to X in X. So this is the same than minimizing for X unconstrained C transpose X plus phi of X plus the indicator function of the set X at the point X, XX. Better in Portuguese, she sound. This is the utility of indicator functions in optimization, is that it allows us to get rid of the constraints via this object that has the disadvantage that brings us to the extended reals, right? It introduces infinity. So from the numerical point of view, this is not a good transformation, but from the theoretical, where we have to write optimality conditions, it is. So then we will be working with a function f of x equal to this C transpose x plus, so the linear term, the expected records term, and the indicator term. So if we characterize, we will be dealing with an optimization problem of this form for a function that goes into the extended reals. And this is a setting, and it's convex and proper. So this is a setting that we are considering for characterizing the optimal value, the a minimizer of this problem. So X bar minimizes F in the whole of space in R and X, if and only if the sub-differential of this function includes the zero. This is a generalization of the Fermat condition zero equal to the gradient of the function at X bar. Good. So let's now go and do our proof. Okay, I will not be lazy. I will write it again if I need it. I will erase it. Okay, so it is not very difficult, in fact, to prove this to prove this equivalence. It's just the definition of the subdifferential. So zero belongs to the subdifferential f of x bar is equivalent to say that the hyperplane with slope zero supports the graph of the function. This is the same that saying that for all x in the space, f of x is larger or equal than this hyperplane, that is f of x bar plus zero transpose x minus x bar. Oh, zero, this term is zero. So this is equal than f of x bar. So f of x bar is smaller than f of x for all x in Rn. This is equivalent to saying that x bar minimizes f. So this also is here. It's a very simple result, but it's very useful because now let me see. We can go, no, we can, this I will, we will not prove. This is a consequence of the Mororo-Kafeler theorem. It's, you can, it's, well, I will just write the name. The theorem Mororo-Kafeler. And by the way, Moreau will not come because he passed away last year, but Rockefeller will come to our thematic program and will give a special conference in the week of the 20th of June as part of this our thematic program. The theorem of Moreau-Rockefeller establishes conditions under which for a convex function that is defined as a sum, if f equal to f1 plus f2 for when the subdifferential of the sum, I mentioned this in one of the first classes, at the point is equal to the sum of the subdifferentials. And this involves conditions that are called regularity conditions and are related to what nonlinear programming people call constraint qualifications. When, as it says there, so there you can go and see the result in the Shapiro, Cheva, and Ruzhinsky book in the chapter 7, I think, is in the background material. So when F1 and F2 are polyhedral, and we have also, we're considering that they are finite value, in fact, so the set differential, all these results, the Morrow-Rockefeller results, are meaningful for functions that are have extended real values, when we have infinities, because the self differential of, you can think, this function may have an infinite value at x bar, and then the sub differential will be the empty set. While, for example, the sum of the two functions at x bar may be finite. So you may very well have the sub differential of the function defined as a non-empty set at x bar, but one of those two may be empty because of the because the function became has an infinite value. Well, and then this is why you have to worry about this spreading the distributing the sub differential in the along the sum for extended real valued functions. For functions that are real valued, that do not take plus infinity values, the quality always holds. When one of those conditions that are given regularity conditions that are given in this Morrow-Rockefeller theorem are automatic when the functions are polyhedral. So this also holds. When the functions are not polyhedral, if the intersection of the interiors of the respective domain, so here int is missing. So if there is a point that is in the interior of both of them, then this somehow helps to get rid of infinities and empty sets. And then we have the equality too. But well, this is all what I will say, and you will not have to prove it. Just go and read all the conditions in this theorem of Morrow-Rockefeller, if you are interested in the details. Good. So now I think I have shown everything I wanted to show to prepare our the proof of the theorem. So let's let me see if we go back. No, we'll go forward. Okay. So another thing. Sorry. You see that the characterization of the subdifferential, including the zero subgradient at the point x bar, is gives a condition that is necessary and sufficient for x bar to minimize f. This is because the function is convex, right? So it is a necessary and sufficient condition, and we are here in the we are always dealing with convex stochastic programs, the linear case or the convex case, where instead of having, for example, a linear cost here, we can have a convex function. We are always in a, so we will have F1 will be a convex function. We are always in the convex world for all the results here. There are some methods and some results for non-convex, but they, well, of course, we will only have, this will characterize critical points, stationary points, not, there will be maximum, minimum, and saddle points. The characterization for convex, the full characterization is only for convex functions. So for our case, we are in the, everything is convex. We, this is a convex function, this is a convex set, a polyhedral set, and this is the expected record function is also convex. Okay, so we have a necessary and sufficient optimality condition that we will show first then for this the case where we have a finite support, so k scenarios W1 until Wk. So saying that point x bar solves the two-stage stochastic linear program is equivalent to saying that we have multipliers. Remember that I mentioned that there is always, it's always primal dual, these characterizations, one for each of the scenarios under consideration. And we have a multiplier that corresponds to the constraint in the set capital X, AX equal B, such that if we consider the recurse function evaluated at X bar, for the k scenario, then so if we maximize like this, this is q of x bar at xk, then those multipliers are maximizers, so they give the value of the reciprocal function at x bar, so at the optimal at this point. And the sum, well, this inequality holds. Pk, tk transpose, p bar k plus a transpose mu is smaller than c. And there is a complementarity here, condition between x bar and what will be the negative, if you pass to this side of this vector here. So when this one is has components that are strictly positive, here there is equality at these constraints because this needs to be zero, right? This is what is saying. Okay, so I let you guess how we will show this. We will use all these results that we proved before, and we will pass through the characterization of a solution of a convex problem, that is the two-stage stochastic linear program, of finding a zero element, a zero subgradient in the subdifferential of our function. So now, so we come here. And for our, I will need more than one blackboard, so I will erase here. For our finite support case, so we will have that the two-stage stochastic linear program is minimize f of x, x in R. And x for f will have three terms. C transpose x plus phi of x plus the indicator function of our first stage feasible set. And phi of x is the expected records function, so where phi of x is the sum over all the scenarios of the probabilities times the records function evaluated at x at the scenario k. Okay, so to apply our result here that here we first need to see that f is proper and convex. Well, this is a linear function. It has full domain. So let me call it f1, f2, f3 of x. F1 of x, the domain of F1 of x is, well, it's linear, and the domain is the whole space, so it's Rn x. F2, well, and it's a linear function, so it's clearly convex, and it's proper, then it also has the full domain. The records function, we also show that the domain here is the domain of this records function is the positive half of W. So and here we are in a finite support setting. It's also F2, the domain of F2. So we all, it also domain of F2 is WK. The intersection of all those positive halves. And F3 is the domain of F3 is the set capital X. Okay, so having and what else? Actually, so all those, this is a sum of proper functions. They don't have infinite value, minus infinite value everywhere. There are five values where it is finite. And in fact, our result is supposes, let me come back here, that we have a point so that our set, first I set, is non-empty, and where the recurse function is finite. So the function f is proper and convex. And therefore, we can characterize a solution minimizes the two-stage linear program if and only if 0 belongs to the subdifferential of f at x bar. Now, in the finite support case, we know not only that the function phi is proper and convex, but we know that it's polyhedral. Now, okay, here, because omega has finite support, phi is polyhedral, and now I ask you, a linear function is polyhedral? It is the simplest case of a polyhedral function. So f1 is polyhedral. The definition of polyhedral was that the function is the sum of a maximum of affine functions plus the indicator function of a polyhedron. So a linear function is polyhedral, and because the set capital X is a polyhedron, the function f3 is polyhedral too. And so is f3. So we can use the Moreau-Rockefeller result. And then we have that x bar minimizes f is equivalent to 0 belongs to the subdifferential of f1 of x bar plus the subdifferential of f2 plus the subdifferential of f3. Okay, so who is f1? F1, it's a very simple a function that is differentiable, and so the subdifferential is a singleton. It is the vector c. The subdifferential of f2, we showed, or I don't remember who showed, but we wrote. It's the subdifferential of the expected recurse function. So because the probabilities are positive, it is the sum of the probabilities times the subdifferential of the expected recurse function. So it is the sum and the subdifferential of f3, we just shown, it is the the subdifferential of the indicator function of this polyhedron. So it is a normal cone to this polyhedron, and the normal cone has the expression nu in R and B such that nu is equal to minus A transpose mu minus P for mu and B P and X non-negative P complementary with X bar. Okay, so we have pieced together all the parts. The only thing that is missing now is to remember what was the subdifferential of the recurse function for each fixed scenario, Xk. And here is where we were using duality theory in linear programming to characterize all the vertices, all the of the feasible set in the dual formulation. And then we had that form, the subdifferential of the recurse function at the fixed realization was, we were writing it like this, I think, Tk transpose and all the solutions of the dual. I will not fit there. Okay, I will write it down here. I will do that. For subdifferential Ck equal to the minus Tk transpose, the technology matrix, times the set of maximizers of the dual problem, dual second stage problem, Phk minus Tkx for P such that W k transpose P smaller than Q. Okay, so this was the set P of Qk. Good. So we know then that zero belongs to the sum of these three sets. So we have to put everything together. So zero belongs to this inclusion means that there is one element, there are elements in each of these sets such that we have zero inequality. So I will write here the zero. Now let me see how to write. So here there is only one element, so it's C. In the subdifferential of F2, there is some pk, that is how it is called in the statement, in this set of maximizers, where we have zero equality. That makes the inclusion true. And here, in the set of the third function, we will have some normal element that we will call nu k. And to this nu k, there will be associated mu k and pk. And mu will be that the one that is there. So the inclusion means or holds and only if there is so pk here in this set, pk it is for each realization k between 1 and k, such that pk here in the argmax of the second stage problem in the above, in the linear, in the dual formulation. There is then here nu k. Nu bar, not nu k, sorry, nu bar. Here we don't have k. K is here the sum. Pk for k between 1 and k. There is a nu bar in the normal cone. Okay, such that zero is equal now, so this is the element, these are the elements that make this inclusion true, such that then C, zero is equal to C plus the sum of pk minus tk transpose pk. Yes, it's okay, and plus nu bar, plus nu bar. I think I call them p bar k. Let's put bars here so that, because it's for each k, each scenario fixed. P bar k and nu bar. Okay, good. So a nu bar is equal to here minus A transpose mu bar minus P bar for some of elements in this satisfying this condition. So minus A transpose mu bar minus P bar for P bar non-negative and complementary with X bar. Okay, well, but we are there because now you see the PKs, P bar Ks are in the sets where we want to. Now we need to show these two conditions. And you are just guessing that all this term, in fact, will be our a positive term P in the normal element because it's complementary with X bar. And this will be, well, you will see what it is. So now let's write here the what replace by nu bar in the relation we have in the identity we have then for the sum between 1 capital K pk. I will put the term minus here, so minus tk transpose p bar k plus nu bar that in fact has only negative terms, so minus A transpose mu bar minus P bar. This means then that all these okay, so then with P bar larger or equal to zero. So minus P bar is smaller or equal to zero. So we have that C minus the sum of K between 1 and K of PK TK transpose P bar K minus A transpose mu bar is smaller. C minus is equal to P bar. Right, I'm adding P bar to both terms. And well, I should have written P bar equal to C minus. And then P bar is larger or equal to zero. Then C is larger or equal than the sum of those two terms. And this is our first relation. Good. So the second bullet. Now, the third bullet also is straightforward because P transpose bar, since P bar transpose X bar is equal to zero, this, in view of the equivalent, the relation here, this is the same as saying that I wrote first X transpose P. Okay, that's write P transpose X bar as X transpose P. By 2, this is the same that saying that X transpose bar x bar in a product with C minus the sum of PKT, K transpose P bar K minus A transpose mu bar is equal to 0. And this is the third bullet. Okay, so this is, I have not completed all the if and only if, in fact, because what we did was to show that if 0 belongs to the subdifferential, then the conditions hold, right? Because we are showing the three conditions. Now, to go the other way, it's rather simple, because we just need to prove that with these conditions, this vector here, we can be in the vector nu such that the sum is 0, and since this belongs to the subdifferential of F1, this belongs to the subdifferential of F2, and this belongs to the subdifferential of F3, then 0 belongs to the subdifferential of the sum, and this is the same that it belongs to the subdifferential of F at X bar, and then we finish, we come back and finish with the if and only if proof. So this finishes, concludes. The proof of X bar minimizes implies the three conditions. So you can prove the reverse. This, as I said, can show the reverse implication. You have all the tools, all the weapons to kill this proof. Okay, so for people who is familiar with linear programming, this is resembles a lot to the linear programming conditions, the primal dual conditions. This is so complementarity. This corresponds to here we have the dual feasibility, and this is related to primal optimality, primal and dual optimality, and this is the condition on strict complementarity. Primal and dual feasibility follow from the fact that we are saying that X bar is in X and that P bar is in the set, in the dual feasible set. Good. There is another way of making this proof that doesn't use the results of subdifferentials, and it's just remembering that in this finite support case, we can write our stochastic linear, the two-stage stochastic linear program, not in two levels, but all together. It is the same. This will not be the case in all the situations. Here, I forgot PK here. Here there is the probability is missing. So if we write all together as a large linear program, the two-stage problem, that is with here and now variables and wait and see variables, then we obtain a very large linear programming problem. Everything is linear here. Here there is a PK missing. You see here now we have variables x and yk. We resolve all at once the here and now decisions and the corrections for all the possible situations we foresee in our sampling space that has k scenarios only. Okay, so we can write the optimality conditions for the linear programming problem, and then you will get something that to be like to compare to be equivalent to what we have as the three conditions needs a little trick, and it is that when you write the Lagrangian and the dual, and you see that there is no duality gap, and then you equate objective primal dual objective optimal primal objective with a dual optimal dual objective. Here, the multiplier that depends then on the scenarios, we don't use the standard inner product, but we use an inner product where we multiply by the probability, pk. Because the probabilities are equal, are positive, we have here equalities, nothing changes, and if there were inequalities, they would not change the inequalities, we would have the same solution. And then we write the optimality conditions for this problem. And this is the way, so we have to multiply here by the probability pk when writing the Lagrangian, and then this means that in fact we are using an inner product that is weight. It corresponds to what is called the dual pairing in the probability space. We are always having the weight of the probabilities when we use, when we make the product between primal and dual variables. Okay, so then just to finish, what happens if we have a continuous distribution? Exactly the same result can hold, and I wrote here the statement for a case with simple recurse, so the simplest of the fixed recurses. It is not in the book, it is a particular case. But you can, this is in simple recurse, remember, every object that is to be uncertain is random except for the right-hand side variable h. So we have only h of w. And then, moreover, this matrix, the recurse matrix, is of the form identity minus identity. So in this case, why I wrote this is because I don't have to worry about a lot of technical assumptions that need to be applied for splitting the subdifferential of the sum in the sum of the subdifferentials. Because with the expected, so it is essentially the same process, but we will not have sums, we will have integrals when we deal with the expected recurse function. But what we have is that for splitting the subdifferential of the sum in the sum of the subdifferentials, so now we will be dealing okay, sorry, I have a call. I have no idea. I would reject it because I don't know who it is. And it's a tablet, it's not a phone. So we have then, okay, I have to come back to what I was saying. So we have the three terms, right? Our function f of x with the continuous distribution, then again is f1 of x plus f2 of x plus f3 of x. F1 is easy. It's just C transpose x. F2 is the one that is more delicate because it's expected recurse functions and we have integrals now. And F3 is the same one of before and before, so it's also not a problem. The potential problem can come from phi of x. But we showed that for that we proved, I'm thinking this blackboard even, for the case of simple fixed recurse, the recurse is complete. And recurse is complete. And because of the particular form of our matrix W, we have that the domain of the function is the positive half of W, and this is actually the whole space, Rn, nx. No, nm was here in y, in the matrix, in the y dimension. And why this is of use? Because let's go back here. So here the domain of the first function is the whole of is the whole of the space. No, then it's x, is x, sorry, so it's Rnx. Phi? Yes, it's x. No, it's not both, it's the whole of Rn here. is RnX. Mm? This is what we showed in last class. So here, the first function has full domain because it's a linear function. The second function, phi, has full domain because we're in the very simple case, in the case of fixed simple records. And the third function has the set capital X as domain. So the intersection, as if we are assuming that X bar is in X, it holds trivially, and we can split the sum and apply the Mororo-Kafeler theorem. Mm? Otherwise, there are some, in the theorems in the book, there are some assumptions that are technical and that introduced for that reason. Okay, so then what's the difference then if everything is equal? What's the difference? Well, the difference is now that we have then the multipliers P. Mm? Before, you see, the dimension of the multipliers P in the finite support case, there are as many as scenarios. Mm? When omega has an infinite number of events, so it's a continuous distribution, then P becomes a function, a random variable, and it's a function of the scenarios. Mm? And then so P, for each omega, we'll have a P, we'll have infinite omegas. And then P, it's a measurable function, like when we were, well, like along the lines of what we saw last class. Mm? So, and that's, yes, that's all. Ah, well, ah, no, okay, so I had written. So because of the, we have simple records, things get simplified, and there are not a lot of conditions that are technical and that are important to be aware that they have to be satisfied for the cases where records is relatively complete, for example. Mm? Okay, good. So, what I will do is maybe put, but we are almost done. Okay, it's a mute. That's strange. Okay, nobody ever calls me here, must be. Okay, other than another thing, how do we write, how can we simplify then the optimality conditions? Sorry, let's go back here. So you see that our characterization involves sums multiplied by pk. In the continuous case, this becomes expected values. Hmm? It's the integral over with taking the integral with respect to the measure dp of omega and t of omega, p of omega, and so on here. So in these two terms, we will have expected values. And this is, since we are in the simple records, we don't have t. T is not random, mm? So we'll get out of the expected value. And then, well, the result is that T plus expected value of our measurable function P that depends on omega plus A transpose mu is smaller than C. And there is complementarity, and now this term has this expected value. So the optimality conditions are a translation from the discrete to the continuous universe, and everything is, well, is as it should be. Hmm? There are no surprises. Okay, so do we have questions? Yes, we have one question.
Pi can be a set.
Who?
Pi.
It is one. It's any. It's it's one.
For each W, it could be a set.
For each W, it is a set. But the one there is one. We are not saying that it's unique. Hmm? It is one that satisfies the inclusion. Zero belongs to the subdifferential of the sums. There may be more than one. There is no uniqueness. So the question is if the I have to turn. The question is if the multiplier P cannot be, there is no need for it, there is no reason for it to be unique. And no, there is no reason for it to be unique. So P for each W can be belong to a set. There is more than one. Depends if the, there is, for example, it will be unique if this constraint, there is linear independence here. Hmm? There is uniqueness of the multiplier, but we do not know. What we know is that there exists one, but there can exist more than one, where the relation is satisfied for each omega.
So for each omega, you choose one in a measurable way?
Yes, there is one that... There is one that satisfies those relations, and there may be more than one. Hmm?
In this case, with simple records, actually W is independent.
But because it's I minus I, you are right. So Juan Pablo is rightfully pointing out that in the case where we have simple records, or the records matrix is. The identity minus identity, so there is linear independence, and P will be unique. But in the general case, there is no reason for it. OK, some other question? No? OK, so thank you very much, and happy Easter, and see you next week.